Hi. In this video, I'm going to describe how the phase alignment application described in a deformable shape tracker in this GitHub repository has been ported to Vitis, Xilinx Vitis environment in order to implement the corresponding phase alignment algorithm with reconfigurable hardware. The original paper that described the algorithm that we're going to use is this one here, 1 millisecond phase alignment with an ensemble of regression trees from 2014 by Kazemi and Sullivan. And as you can see, the target is to detect landmarks in an image corresponding to specific facial positions. And the applications of this process is face expression recognition, drowsiness detection, monitoring user reactions, for example, to advertisements, etc. In this first video, we're going to summarize and try to make clear some concepts and terms that are used in the original paper by Kazemi and Sullivan in order to comprehend how the porting and, has been performed and what is displayed in the final code that we are going to use. So, originally, a shape is defined which consists of p landmark coordinates. So each one of these elements in the S set, in the capital S set, which is the shape, is a pair of coordinates. X1 is a pair of coordinates for the first landmark, X2 is the pair of coordinates of the second landmark, etc. Capital I is the image. We refer to grayscale images, because we're gonna compare, as you will see in following slides, grayscale intensities between different pixels. So if we're talking about a color image, this color image has first to be transformed into grayscale, has to be converted in grayscale, and then we're gonna use it in the algorithm. Then S hat is the estimated shape in the T regressor. There are an overall number of capital T cascade stages which are called regressors. When moving from one cascade stage to the other, from T to T plus one, capital S, the shape S, is updated as follows. The new shape estimation is the previous shape estimation at regressor T, incremented by a correction factor RT, which depends on the image itself, I. You can understand that when I'm talking about image, we refer to a two-dimensional matrix, and the previous estimate S hat. RT depends on both of these parameters. Now, let's see also how the training of the model that we're going to use has been produced. The training used capital N pairs of images and annotated shapes. This means that in each one of the pairs, I1, S1, I2, S2, etc., the I1, I2, or whatever, is the image, the corresponding training image, and its companion, capital S1, capital S2, are the ground truth, let's say, the landmarks in their correct position. PI is one of the indexes between 1 and capital N, but we distinguish it from I, because PI will be used when we focus on only one of the training images, and in order to estimate the position of the of the shape for this specific eye image, we have to average somehow the corresponding landmark positions of the rest of the training images. We will see it in a few slides. So the initialization of the training process uses three parameters, uses the following triplet: the selected image IPI, capital IPI, its shape estimation, not the ground truth for this specific image, its estimation, which initially at the regressor number 0 is estimated from the rest of the ground truth shapes. So if we're talking about S5, let's say, we're going to use all the ground truth shapes but S5, and from the rest of them we're going to calculate the average positions of the landmarks. And this average position of the landmarks will form the estimated shape I, the S hat I, at the initial regressor 0. The third thing that we're going to define is the difference between the actual value, the ground truth for this specific image, number I, from the estimated shape, S hat I. This is called residual. In each one of the regressors, I remind you that regressor is called each one of the cascade stages, and how many cascade stages we're going to use. We're going to use just 10 cascade stages in our application. So when moving to the cascade stage TAF plus 1, the estimated shape is the estimated shape from the previous cascade stage plus a correction factor RT, as we said earlier. And we also defined earlier in the previous slide again this residual here, delta S, which is the difference between the ground truth and the estimated shape for this specific image. Now, in each cascade stage, RT is the final value of a parameter F, which is updated in capital K stages, which K is a relatively large number, is 500 in our implementation. So there will be in each cascade, in each regressor, which is the same as I'm calling it, in each cascade stage, a repetition of 500 times where FK will be updated before we get the final value of FK and assign it to RT. The F0 is estimated by this equation here, which actually is the square error between a vector gamma with dimensions equal to the number of landmarks and the residuals. So we find a vector gamma which minimizes this difference here below. Of course, this concerns the training stage. We are not going to implement a training stage. We're going to skip this step. We're just going to use the inference because we're just interested in analyzing a new image. So this is just for information, for your information of how the initial value of F0 is retrieved. Now, in each one of the K iterations of the 500 iterations of the 500 tests, as they are called in the terminology of the original work. F is updated as a function of another function which is called weak regressor, and its name is G. The following algorithm is performed for each test K. The parameter R for a specific image I and the specific iteration K is the difference between the residual delta S and the FK minus 1 from the previous stage. We have to fit a regression tree to the specific RIK value. In the next slide, we're going to see what this means. What does a regression tree fitting means? But from this slide, we can simply say that the fitting that we're going to use concerns the estimation of the weak regressor function GK for this specific iteration number K. If we get this specific GK value, then we use it in the update function below, which gives us the F value for the specific kth iteration as a function of the previous FK minus 1 value plus the weak regressor GK multiplied by a learning rate factor, which is actually a forgot factor, because it is less than 1, its value is actually 0.15 from the pre-trained model. And this value multiplies GK before it is added to the previous FK minus 1 value in order to estimate the FK at the specific iteration. And after all the iterations finish, all the 500 iterations finish, the last FK value is assigned to the RT that is going to be used, as we said earlier, at this equation here, where we defined the new shape estimate for the next regressor, the next of the 10 regressors. So if I return back to the algorithm that I described earlier, I have to move now to the next slide, which describes actually this phase here, which is the fit to a regression tree. What does this mean? First of all, the trees that we're gonna use in our implementation have depth 5, and they're binary trees. So this means that we have 31 nodes, and we have to visit specific nodes in a path from the root of the tree down to a leaf. So we will visit 5 of the 31 nodes before we reach the leaf. And what do we do in each one of these nodes? The purpose of this tree is in each node to compare the intensities in grayscale of predetermined, predefined U and V pixels. Which are will be these pixels is defined in the training model, and their intensity difference is compared to a threshold TAF. If their difference is higher than TAF, then the left direction on a specific node is followed, otherwise the right direction. When we reach the leaf node, there we will find the value of the weak regressor G. And this value will be used, I'm going back to the previous slide, will be used as we saw earlier here. So this GK value is retrieved after walking the tree from the root down to a leaf. Which path we're gonna follow depends on the comparisons of the intensities of specific pixels U and V, and as you see here in the At the bottom of the slide, we're not referring just to U and V, but to U prime and V prime. You will understand why in the next slide, because we are not going to use the absolute reference U and V values, but we're going to use the values that have been transformed after some warping that has to be done to the image that we're analyzing. So let's forget this for example. Let's have in mind that in each node of the tree, 2 pixels and their intensity of 2 pixels have to be compared, and their difference will determine what kind of path we're going to follow from the root of the tree down to the leaf. So in each node, in each one of the 31 nodes that each one of these trees has, there will be stored, we will find stored in the pre-trained model, these 4 parameters. These 4 parameters are the indices of the U and V reference pixels, the threshold TAF, and the weak regressor value G. Let's talk a little bit more about what do U and V represent in the initial image. First of all, the initial full resolution image is not used. The application uses a sparse representation of the image. Of course, here at the top, I am showing you a uniformly resolution degraded image, but we do not have this kind of sparse image. We may have sparse scattered around some landmarks points that we're interested in, but what we have to remember is that from the full resolution image we're just using 400 pixels, capital P, pixels only. Why is that? Because we do not want to check all the large number of pixels of the full resolution of the initial image, but just a smaller number of indicative pixels around the landmarks. Each pair U and V pixels, as you can see, I have placed 2 indicative pixels here, U and V, the stars are corresponding to U and V, and each pair has a closest landmark, like the one shown by the arrow here, which is also associated, let's say, with this pair of pixels. Now, the initial position of U and V are defined having as a reference the pre-trained model, and more specifically the mean shape. The mean shape in the pre-trained model is actually the average position of each one of the 68 landmarks that we're using in our application. So U and V have been defined in correspondence to these mean landmark positions of the training of the trained model. However, in our final image that we're currently analyzing, the position of the face will not match the position of the mean shape that we take from the pre-trained model. So what has to be done is that we have to warp somehow the real image. We have to distort it somehow, shrink it, rotate it slightly, slide it up, down, right, whatever, in order to match the face that is displayed in the new image with the mean shape that we have from the pre-trained model. Let's see how this warping can be performed. In the terminology of the original paper, global similarity and local translations have to be performed. Let's denote the closest landmark to U as KU. Now, the scaled distance between U and its closest landmark is this distance here. You can view this difference as this subtraction here, as the estimation, for example, of the Euclidean distance between the pixel U and its closest landmark XKU. Now, in the final image, we have to take again the reference closest landmark XIKU and add to it the Euclidean distance that we previously estimated, but of course in the new image this distance has to be updated, has to be rotated, shrinked, in order to do the necessary warping, as we said earlier. So this delta XU is not just added to the new landmark XIKU, but is added after scaling it and rotating it using the 1 over scaling factor SI multiplied by the rotation vector R, capital RI. So, again, I estimate the distance between the closest landmark and the U pixel in the reference model, and then I scale it and rotate it using 1 over SI multiplied by capital RI before I add this updated, this modified distance to the new landmark position, to the landmark position. And this one, this addition will give us the U prime, which is the position of the pixel U in the new image. Or hopefully the position. We cannot find it, we cannot find the exact position, but hopefully we're going to approach it. Now, SI and capital RI, which is the rotation and the scaling factor, can be determined by using the mean square error using the equation above. And concerning specifically the rotations, in the implementation, as we're going to see in our next videos, we will use rotation vectors, which are actually the cosine and the sine of the angle that we want to rotate. And in short, we will refer to cosine and sine as C and S. And from these values, we will have to use the Jacobi matrix, capital J, of the rotation vector J, which is formally defined as you can see in the middle. But if S and C are real values, not complex values, this can be simplified, as you can see at the bottom of this slide.